Welcome and good evening. Thanks for turning out. This is kind of cool. I've actually known Bernie for a while now, and I've just met David. Tonight they're going to be sharing obviously very different viewpoints and very different aspects of how they think the kind of world works, and I would really appreciate it, and I know you guys are great and you're adults and everything is good. I'd really appreciate it if we could be respectful of one another, if we could have a good time, we could encourage each other in our thoughts, even if they're completely different, and if our beliefs are kind of in conflict, that we could have an open discussion and a healthy discussion, and we could get together with both these guys in our question and answer phase, or afterward even, and just share and just learn, and kind of put the swords down, so to speak, because these things can kind of get energetic and heated, and and be respectful and just have a really good time. So thank you so much for coming out. We don't have a whole lot of time. I did not know that. So the flow is going to be Bernie's going to speak for 30 minutes. He's got quite a lot to set up. And some of the things he's going to do, he's going to introduce the thoughts, the theories, the ideas. So we've given him a little bit more time. And then David is going to speak for about 15 minutes. And then we're going to have 15 minutes for question and answer. So if things extend or you didn't get a chance, please just write it down and we'll hopefully find a little nook or a place outside that we can keep the conversation going. And if for any individual information on either of these two gentlemen, we can get you guys plugged in with emails or websites and stuff like that afterwards. So, excuse me. Needed to say this as well. Both of these gentlemen would just like you guys to know, neither of them believe that they speak necessarily for every atheist or every Christian or secular humanist, whatever title you'd like to go by. So by no means are they claiming to represent everyone. They're here to represent their beliefs and put out the best efforts and thoughts and research that they've come to that's brought them to their decision. So they want to make that clear. Anyways, without much further ado, so I don't waste you guys' time, we'll get this clock started and we'll open the floor to Mr. Bernie Dehler.
Thank you, Justin. You can sit here. Before I start, I'd like to introduce also Dr. Bart Rask. He's in the back there. With his hand up. We're going to do this topic again in Vancouver next month, and we're going to have 2 hours to do it. So because of limited Portland hour times, that's why we don't have very much time here. Okay, so tonight I'm going to explain why I left Christianity in this for two scientific reasons. And, you know, the topic of this section or this lecture today is, does science destroy Christianity? It should really be Christian theology to be more accurate. But I dumbed it down just so it kind of makes more sense to people when they read it. And it is kind of the same thing, basically. So to start off with, I want to say that I believe there's two ways to have knowledge of the world, everything in the world. There's science and there's philosophy. And philosophy deals with a lot of different questions, but basically the science is the facts of the world. And philosophy, where we don't have facts, we use philosophy to talk about a lot of things. So some philosophical discussions are, for example, is there a soul? Where did I come from? What happens when you die? Also morality. What is morality? There's different systems. And so some of these categories are also labeled under religion. So I see religion as a subset of philosophy. So if you have a theistic viewpoint, you could have a theology. And if you don't, then you would have a philosophy. So in the big picture of things, I think you have science and philosophy. And so basically what I'm going to be saying tonight is that science destroys Christian theology or a Christian type of philosophy. So basically I left for two reasons, and I'm not sure if either one of these is good enough on its own to have done the job, but basically the two scientific reasons are evolution and biological evolution, and the other one is neurology, which has to do with the soul, whether there is a soul and what is a soul. So I would say that the idea of biological evolution, for me, I would say it rips the heart right out of traditional Christian theology, and neuroscience can contribute to ripping the heart right out of the soul, the philosophy of a soul. And if there's no soul, that means we have no eternal life. We need to deal with that. So before I start, I want to say it's a very important thing in evolution. A very important thing to understand is that according to biological evolution, there is no such thing as a first human or first people. This is a book Richard Dawkins put out. It's really a pretty entertaining book. It's called The Magic of Reality, and he has a whole section, a chapter on this. There is no human, or who is the first human? Well, there's no such thing as a first human. So I want to talk about that briefly before I get into some more of the ramifications on evolution. So basically he says, you know, here's a thought experiment to do. Let's say, for example, you have a picture of your father, and then you take a picture of his father, and you stack all these pictures up. Of course, we don't have photography to go back millions of years, so it's a thought experiment. So what do you think your 185th million grandparent might look like? Well, when you look at that, it would look like a fish. You know, all the creatures we see today, like the apes and the monkeys, they're our cousins. We're relatives to everybody that's alive today. Now, an analogy he has, too, is we kind of see this in life a little bit, this transitionary, in our own lives. For example, you know, when you have a baby, the baby is first an infant, then it becomes a toddler, then it becomes mature. There's never a time where you say, oh, yesterday that we had an infant and today we have a toddler, because it happens gradually over time. But when you look at snapshots of that baby over time, you can say, well, definitely here's a baby, definitely here's a toddler, here's definitely a teenager, here's mature, and then maybe over here is when grandpa has dementia or whatever. So in the same way, you can do this thought experiment. Another one he gives is that, let's say you had a time machine and you went back to look at these creatures every 10,000 years or so. If you went back 10,000 years, you would find your ancestor, it would look pretty much like a human. Now, one of the things about species is that they can breed with each other. So if you went back 10,000 years, this person could breed with the person that is with you now, if you had a time machine, for example. So then if you went back another 10,000 years and picked up another person, well, that person would also be able to interbreed. He said you'd probably have to go back somewhere between 100,000 to a million years before you would get this creature that would no longer be able to interbreed. But remember that, you know, if you looked at everybody's parent, they all look pretty much identical. So when you take a snapshot in time, you know, every parent looks like there's not really any changes. But when you take big snapshots, like every million years, you see some big differences. So that's a very important concept, basically, to understand. Something about evolution, too. There's the fact of evolution, and then there's a theory of evolution. The theory of evolution talks about the mechanisms of how evolution happened. Like in Darwin's time, it was the primary idea was natural selection and random mutation. Since then, we've discovered DNA and other mechanisms too. For example, horizontal gene transfer. This means you're getting DNA into your genome. That's all your DNA. That's not from ancestry. It's coming from another species in the environment. So there's a whole lot of factors at play. So this is what scientists are trying to figure out exactly how it happened. But that it happened is a fact. And that can be seen through example, it used to be seen with just the fossil record, but now with DNA since the year 2000, they've mapped the human genome and all these other animals and compared them, and they can see how through time the things have changed. And for example, one of the interesting things is pseudogenes. This means a pseudogene is a gene that no longer works because it's busted. And one of the famous examples is ascorbic acid, which is vitamin C. We have a busted gene, so we need to eat vitamin C because our body can't make it. And the apes have the same problem. But other ancestral animals do make their own vitamin C. And it's been said that for the nose alone, the olfactory sense, there's more than 1,000, there's thousands of pseudogenes just for the smelling sense alone. So now I'm going to get into some ramifications for Christian theology. The most literal interpretation would be a young earth creationist, and an example of this is Answers in Genesis with Ken Ham. He has the Creation Museum in Kentucky. This is the one that shows the dinosaurs and humans living side by side. Now, this is such a bad conflict that they invent their own kind of science called creation science. And so according to their science, the universe was made over a period of 6 days, including the earth and the universe, less than 10,000 years ago. Now, according to modern science, the universe is almost 14 billion years. That means for every day they think there's been an existence, there's been actually a million years. So, 1 year is equal to a million years because they think it's 10,000 years in existence and it's really around 14 billion. So what they think is 1 year has really been a million years. There's been a million years of activity for every year they think there's been activity. So it's off by a factor of a million. They believe in a worldwide flood about 4,000 years ago that wiped out all the air breathers, except for there's 8 humans that were saved on the ark and the animals that were saved on the ark. So they're going to have a tough time explaining the biodiversity from that. And they think this fossil record, they see fossils, they know there's fossils. They think all this fossil record was laid down at the global flood time. So in summary, there's a major conflict with modern science, the age of the universe, whether there's a global flood or not, and if humans evolved from animals. So if you're a young Earth creationist, so I said science destroys Christianity. Well, they could say, well, maybe it would if it was true, but modern science is not true. It's all wrong. Creation science is true. So, you know, they don't think there's a conflict, but if you believe in modern science, then their theology is all destroyed right there. So there's another group that comes up a notch that accepts more science. They're called Old Earth Creationists or Progressive Creationists, and this is represented by, for example, Reasons to Believe with Hugh Ross and Fazel Rana. They both have PhDs, Hugh Ross in astrophysics and Fazel Rana in microbiology. So unlike Ken Ham, these guys are science professionals, and they're not making grand claims such as all of modern science is wrong. So they pretty much accept the consensus as far as the dating of the Earth and the dating of the universe, but they still have a problem with macroevolution, which means humans evolved from animals. They think God created humans by poof. And they also believe there was a flood, but they think the flood was local, so it wiped out, all the humans were in a local area at one time, and that wiped out everything. But, you know, it seems like the local flood wouldn't make sense, because why would you say birds? If it was a local flood, the birds could easily fly away. And if God was going, and if all the humans were in one area and God was going to destroy them all, why wouldn't God just say, hey, why don't you move out of town or go up to a hill? Why would you go through all that trouble of making a boat? So there's a lot of things that don't make sense, because the story is obviously written for that it was a real worldwide flood. So the major conflict with science they have is macroevolution, which means humans evolved from animals. And they also believe in a local flood, which means that all the humans descended from these eight people on the ark, which is not true according to modern science on biology. There was no bottleneck of eight humans ever. Evolution, the creation of humans. So there's quite a bit of conflict there. So yeah, they would say too, yeah, there's a conflict if you accept modern science, but we think modern science is wrong. So if you believe in modern science, yeah, there's major damage to their theology. It's all wiped out there. Now I got two categories of ones that are open to evolution. First one is Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism, this is the official Catholic teaching of the church. They say they're open to evolution as long as you say God gave souls at one point in time to these hominids. Now, part of the problem is they still think there was a, even though Genesis could be, is figurative, there was an actual event that there was a man and a woman who everybody descended from. And this is why we have original sin, because of their sin. So again, as Dawkins said, there is no such thing as original humans. And so the original human idea shows the conflict with their idea. Now, somebody might say, like, well, what if there's a whole bunch of humans at one point and God just said, okay, boom, I'm going to give you guys a soul now. Now you're humans. This is the Pope wrote, no, you can't. We don't have that option. We believe in a literal couple. They also, even though they don't explain it much, they believe in some kind of Noah's Ark story. They say it pre-configures baptism, you know. So there's another problem there, because there was no bottleneck again in the human population. Now the one I have the hardest time rebutting, especially because it's hard to find people with this position, is evolutionary creationism. And this is represented by Professor Dennis Lamoureux in Canada. He's got three PhDs, two in science and one in theology. And he makes the bold statement, there was no Adam, just as there is no firmament. Just as a firmament is an idea of ancient Hebrew cosmology, this idea of an original human is the same Hebrew ancient idea. So he says there's no conflict at all with science, because the Bible's not a scientific textbook. So that's true. He says, you know, the Earth and the universe is ancient, like science says, no problem. People evolved, no problem. There was no global flood. There was no Noah's Ark, no problem. These are all so-called godly myths to teach a lesson, basically, namely that, you know, humans are sinners and we need a savior. So basically what looks like history in the Bible is really incidental to the main theological message, he would say. So there's absolutely no problem with science whatsoever in that idea. But what happened is now there's a whole new category of problems he created by doing this, and that is theology or philosophy. Because, see, there's theodicy is the problem of evil. How do you explain evil? All these other Christians explained evil by Adam and Eve. They're the one who ushered all this stuff into here. And so he's saying now that Adam and Eve, there is no Adam. So now you have to try to explain the evil. Is all this evil, why is God choosing evolution? And could he do that if he's all loving and all powerful? You know, consider earthquakes and tsunamis. There's hundreds of thousands killed at a time. Mass extinctions, 99% of all species that ever lived are now extinct. Nature's red in tooth and claw. Put poetically, you can say the cheetah with his teeth and claws carved the speed and the grace of the gazelle. And then, you know, is there intelligent design or evil design? Mark Twain once wrote that, you know, if a human invented the fly, he'd be a monster worse than Hitler. When you look at how flies spread disease and you can't bat them away and whatever, they're just so destructive. So that's an interesting thought. Another thing is some people have said that up to 70% of pregnancies have natural abortions. Many a time, the woman doesn't even know she was pregnant. So it's like, what kind of a design is this that a good God would create? Remember, there's no Adam and Eve in this theology. And I couldn't take this path. This was an option I took for a while, but I couldn't stay with it. I've noticed that it seems like my role model, what he did is had a mystical relationship with Jesus. It was all about Jesus. You read the Bible for what you can get. If you like it, you know, that's the stuff you focus on. Don't worry about the theology. Don't worry about things that don't make sense. So a lot of confirmation bias. You know, you only look at the good stuff and forget about the old stuff because you want to focus on Jesus and good stuff. Okay, so now I want to go into neurology, the second thing. So my faith was really hurt at this point, but I went to an ASA conference, American Scientific Affiliation. These are Christians involved in science. And basically what they're saying is because of neurology, we're seeing how the mind basically emerges from the brain. And they're starting to say, well, I guess the soul is also emerging from the brain. So it's to the point now to where, you know, if the mind is emerging from the brain, the soul is getting to be totally redundant because it's basically the same thing as a mind. So so some of the people causing waves in this would be like Nancy Murphy. She's an evangelical theologian who is going to this. You know, it used to be that in philosophy, for example, they said there was this homunculus, which is a little man inside of you. You know, this little man is the one who controls your thoughts and that voice you hear and tells you what to do and all that kind of thing. Well, it turns out that, you know, from neurology now, we know there's different parts of the brain that do different activities at different times. A different part turns on if you're doing a math, a different part if you're in fight or flight response, a different part if you're being reflective and thinking about the day earlier and what you should have done differently. So it shows like there's really no overriding part of the brain that's in control of everything. And also there's been a lot of interesting studies with, for example, epilepsy is when the brain has these electrical storms. And so sometimes one of the solutions they do if it's really bad is they'll separate this bridge between the left and right part of the brain. And they have some interesting experiments they do on people like that to see what, you know, effect they have on their life. There's been an experiment where they had a brain patient, and I can't remember what they did, but basically they asked they showed the person something, and then they asked them later about it, and verbally the person couldn't say anything about it. Then they asked him to write about it, and his hand would write something. So it's like part of his brain knew how to write it and describe it, but his voice, and he couldn't think about it in front. There used to be an idea of this vitalism that the you know, the cells have some kind of life to it. There's a life force, animated life force, and that's not really thought by scientists anymore. And I think one thing that's interesting to think is one day there's gonna be a machine consciousness where, you know, like there's this Google car that can drive by itself. It's aware of its surroundings. You know about Watson computer that can play Jeopardy and beat the human. You know about I think it's Deep Blue, who's the chess player who can beat other humans. So, you know, it's kind of interesting. You put all those three things together and it's connected to the internet. It's like 100 years from now, or maybe 1,000 years from now, maybe this will be a phone app, you know, on your phone, and you can talk to the computer and ask it all these interesting questions. I mean, just think 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now, we could be actually around millions of years from now. So when you think long-term where things are going, it's pretty interesting to think about. And of course, a lot of the Christians think Jesus is always coming back tomorrow, so they're not having that long-term thinking. So here's some problems with the soul, too, especially if you think a soul is given at birth or at conception, which a lot of people don't do maybe for these problems. For example, identical twins, what happens is, I mean, so the question is there two souls given at the conception? Because what happens is, with identical twins, is there's a fertilized egg, and then after some time, the one cell goes to two, then four and eight, and at some point it splits and becomes two people, and there's two of them growing. So maybe there was a half given, I mean, how do you work at that? Because I guess you had to give two souls at conception, because then each gets one, or else each one ended up with half. There's another thing called the chimera, where these two fertilized eggs grow independently, and at some point early in the stage, they join. And so when they join, does this person have two souls now, or do they each get a half at conception? And so, for example, if you see somebody that has like one blue eye and one green eye, that's the indication that they're a chimera. I mentioned the natural abortions too. It's like, well, all these 70% possibly of pregnancies end in abortion. All these fetuses are in heaven. How can they grow? I mean, we know here you are based on your DNA, but also your surroundings mold you. Because if you grew up in a different country, you'd be a different person. So how would you grow up as a baby in heaven or something? And also with dementia, sometimes people say like, oh, Joe, he's got dementia. That's not the real him. But, they don't say that, for example, when he's a toddler. I mean, when he's a toddler, he doesn't have much of a mind either. Do they say, oh, Joe, that's not really him. He just hasn't come into his own yet. I mean, as a toddler, he's emerging as a person. So in dementia, we just see the opposite, where they're dissipating. So that's just the reality. Another thing to consider is on the night you were conceived, there could have been, on average, 300 million sperm competing to get to that egg. And every sperm would make a different you. It's an interesting thought to think about, what am I kind of thing. And then also to think about how would souls work with animals, because, either they don't have souls and we're special, or they do, and then you got all these bugs and animals in heaven and stuff, so maybe just your loved pets are in heaven. It's hard to say. So I thought, is there any way to disprove the resurrection or this hope in the Bible? And at first I thought no, but then when I thought about it, I thought, well, maybe if there's some myths in the Bible, then maybe that would show that it's not reliable when it gives a promise to eternal life, for example. So I did think of some obvious myths. One of them is in Matthew 27. It says when Jesus died on the cross, the graves opened and the saints came out and showed themselves, those in Jerusalem. Well, the way it's tucked in there, it looks like it's obviously something added on. But the problem is it's in the earliest manuscripts, so it's hard for a scholar to say, oh, that was added later. So what happened to these dead people that came back to life? Did they go up to heaven? Did they go back in the graves? Did they have families again? There's no word. It's just kind of like, by the way, this happened in one of them. Another passage in Mark 16 talks about, if you're a believer and they try to persecute you and they tell you to drink poison, it's not going to kill you. I don't think any Christian believes that. And in that one, it's easy to see that it was added. It's not in the original manuscripts. But then you might say, well, why is it in the Bible then if it's not part of the original? And then also, I think this is one of the biggest ones, too. In Acts 1, it talks about Jesus after he rose from the dead for a period of 40 days. He taught to the disciples, and then he ascended into heaven. Well, if you believe that heaven is in the sky and you want to make up a story like that, it makes perfect sense. He ascended into heaven. But today, nobody believes that heaven is in the sky. They say it's in a different dimension. So if we're going to make up a story about that now, we would never say, oh, he ascended up into heaven, because nobody believes heaven's up there. Now we would just say he dissolved into another dimension, no doubt. So it shows how I think somebody got caught telling a story. What else would there be? There's a dramatic effect. Jesus is trying to just rise up there he goes past the clouds. And it says also that one of the angels said, well, just as you see him going into heaven, this is the way he's going to return again. So it makes it sound like, well, they really thought heaven was up there. How much time do I have?
You're about 8 minutes out.
Okay. I want to give a response also to Alvin Plantinga. He wrote a book recently, and he talked about the science and religion conflict. He says, yes, there is a conflict between science and religion. The conflict is with the religion of naturalism. People like Richard Dawkins, they have a religion of naturalism, and that's where the conflict is. And he says, for example, if you believe in evolution, naturalistic evolution, there's no reason to believe that we evolved to know truth, because it's about survival of the fittest, to fit the niche there. So if you're really a materialist, you have no reason to believe that we have evolved to know the truth. That's not what evolution is about. Evolution is not about evolving to know the truth. It's about survival of the fittest. And that's his argument. Mm-hmm. Now, when I read that, I thought it was extremely weak, and probably a lot of people don't know that, so I'm going to explain everything, how I see that. So the way I see evolution, it's really about an arms war. Remember, like I said earlier, the claws and the teeth of the cheetah carved the gazelle, the speed of the gazelle. And, you know, and these animals, they compete with each other. One of them will get some armor, thicker hide. There's this one YouTube video where this one, can't remember what it was, some kind of animal, cow kind of animal, was attacked by lions and drug into the river, and then alligators went after it. And then the herd came back and rescued it, basically. So after all this chewing and punishment, it finally got loose again, this baby, whatever it was. You know, and humans are like any other animals. We fought each other. And what we do is, in order to make weapons, we make these weapons to defend ourselves and also to dominate others. And so whenever somebody comes up with a new interesting invention, they usually weaponize it. So for example, the space age, you know, we have space age warfare. You heard of the Star Wars system. Nuclear technology is great for making nuclear bombs. And so of course you can also get nuclear power from it, but you know, people want to have the power of the bomb behind them. Somebody invents a robot, so how can we weaponize these things? So you know, there's all kinds of neat robots for warfare also. So we push for technology and science for survival. And you know, in fact, some of our fight is against nature. You know, we want to live longer, or you know, as the sun burns out, it gets bigger and it's going to fry the earth. So you know, if we want to survive as a species, we're going to have to get some spaceships and get out of here at some point. So this shows all this need for science. And science doesn't work unless it's in the truth. If you can't progress science if you're not doing things in the truth. The best science wins, and it's the one most aligned to the truth. So obviously, evolution is seeking truth as a byproduct as we survive and try to dominate others. If prayers and casting spells worked in the military, you can be sure the military would advance that technology. They'd have the best prayers in the world. They'd be experts at casting demons and whatever, you know, what they could do. And they don't do that. Why? It's because everybody knows it doesn't work. Not as well as the technology. So in summary, how much time do I have left? Okay, good. So in summary, I want to say, I don't want to just tear down Christianity and then leave you like floating in the wind. I think it needs to be replaced with something. And what I wanted to say earlier was, like I said a little bit, theology is a part of philosophy. It explains things like, you know, what's your morals? Is there a soul? Is there a God? And all these kind of things. So we need to have some ultimate answers about this, like what is the meaning of life, what happens after I die, what's morality. It'd be nice if humanity worked on these things. I mean, if we worked on these as a project, it's kind of like at SETI at home, you know, you can have your computer work in the background to look at these signals, and with all these home computers working in the part-time, it's making like one supercomputer. Well, it'd be nice if humanity could work on a lot of these problems and come to solutions. Instead, we're wasting time in the religion world by coming to church, or you know, to think about what does this imaginary character want from us, and what does this passage mean, and things like that. I went to a recent philosophy discussion group, and the whole thing was death. How do you deal with death? And you know, everybody has their own ideas, but it's like nobody said like, oh, well, philosophy has it all figured out. Here's the answer. Well, there's still so many believers, I think, who have all this baggage, and as long as you believe in God, you're not really going to come to a solution. And by the way, I think we need, when it comes to death, I think we need to work through the so-called typical five stages, which not everybody agrees with, but the five stages is first there's denial, then anger, then negotiation, then depression, and then acceptance. So I think we need to come to acceptance finally. There's a lot of people in denial, and this whole idea of an afterlife is a huge exercise in denial. I'm not going to die. I want to live forever. So it's step one there. I'd like to offer secular humanism as a good belief system for a replacement. It's called a metaphysical naturalistic worldview. So basically, this is the way I would summarize that belief system. This is my own statement. I'd say secular humanism is a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using science and reason. So basically, it's taking all you can from science and philosophy to come up with answers. And, you know, somebody, unlike religion where somebody has a revelation or somebody says they have a revelation from God, That stuff doesn't fit in here. And one thing I'd like you to ask everybody in here to consider is to make a decision to be a truth seeker, to seek, above all, seeking the truth. I did this as a Christian. This is one reason, this is how I was able to leave Christianity. Now, some people might say, well, how could you place anything above God? How could you place seeking truth above God? And I thought, well, here's some ways to justify it. Number one, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. So if what he said is true, the more you search for truth, it should come back to him. So there's nothing to worry about. And the second thing is that if God really created us and gave us brains, he ought to be happy that we use them to the fullest extent. As a parent, I have kids in school, and when they come home with a really good report card, I'm proud of them. So if God did make us and gave us brains, he would be proud of us. So there's nothing to be ashamed of when it comes to thinking as much as you can. So I'm going to leave it with you, and just in your own mind, you can answer that, whether you want to put truth-seeking number one in your life instead of what you might hope to be true, regardless of what reality is, to try to define reality. Thank you.
The same time, he's not going to introduce me.
I've known Bernie for a number of years now, and I'm really impressed with his zeal for truth. And I've got to know him pretty well, and I learned that he, most of the time, he knows what he's talking about. Well, at least some of the time. But at any rate, we go back a ways, and I think we're both really, really truth seekers. He left out one perspective, though. That's mine. I'm a modern flat earther. Now, I look at the accounts and the scriptures where it talks about the earth and realize that those people had no idea that they're on a planet that's spherical. So how do we have right to say when we discover the planet is spherical that they were wrong, it's not flat? Hey, how about the earth ring? Really, the thing that's so exciting is if you consider the early statements, the days and so on in Genesis, it had meaning to those people, but I suggest that there was unwitting allegory there, that these days stand for something, and if you go through that book, it fits perfectly, the different stages in this model. I'm getting sidetracked. I got to get to my thing. I'm going to hand... Bernie said that he had handouts, and so I prepared mine, and then he didn't have any. So, but at any rate, I have 20, and we'll have to share them around. But I didn't hand them out yet because I want to. I don't want the cat out of the bag yet. I'm going to start with a philosophical context. The title is "Wherein Science Supports the Existence of the Biblical God." The bottom line: absolutely everything matters, or absolutely nothing matters. In an absolute sense, there would be, of course, relative matters, but that's the bottom line. Absolutely everything matters, absolutely nothing matters. Now, this first part, the philosophical part, has some concept really packed in there. I can't really expand on them, so listen carefully and you'll get a chance to read it later. Why does somethingness exist at all?
Hey, Dave, can you make sure you talk in front of the microphone? If you want to talk there, maybe just turn the microphone towards you. I mean, if you want to talk there, just turn it. Is that okay? Or just move it back here just to pick you up a little
bit. I like to get animated, okay. So there we go. All right. This isn't for the PA, it's for the recording. Where were we now? Why does somethingness exist at all? Why not absolute, infinite nothingness? But we are here to ask such questions. Thus, we are empirical evidence that at least our relative somethingness does exist. And the null hypothesis of the existence of absolute nothingness, as opposed to relative nothingness, is falsified. If then absolute nothingness does not exist, then how can absolute somethingness not be infinite? Where could it have boundary? Relative somethingness, of course, could be in that it's finite, can bound with other relative somethingnesses, which you might consider relative nothingness. But not absolute nothingness. hey, if it did exist, it'd be something, wouldn't it? Now, what's the consequence? So then if somethingness exists because it cannot not exist, why then would not infinite somethingness or everything exist? And would not such infinite somethingness of necessity include infinite sentience with infinite presence and control? God. So God must exist because infinite somethingness cannot not exist. God thus can be the eternal, uncaused causer. Now you want to argue with me, but you got to wait, okay? Is the island inhabited? One would need negative evidence comprehensive of all somethingness to empirically prove that God does not exist. A rather robust challenge to the atheist perspective, I would suggest. But even a single footprint in the island's sand evidences that it is indeed occupied. Let us search for God's footprint on our part of the island. Science involves the practice of hypothesizing, followed by falsifying all alternative or null hypotheses by empirical tests, thus establishing the primary hypothesis as the most likely truth. Now, to sort of illustrate this, we could have a hypothesis that I'm standing here and a alternate or null hypothesis that I'm sitting on the floor. And you can empirically falsify that I'm on the floor, therefore that I'm standing here is the most likely truth. See how it works? Well, look, that may be funny, but that's the principle.
That's only two possibilities.
Well, I could be all over. Yeah, I agree, but I'm trying to illustrate the principle. Yeah. Adjustments may be made as appropriate, and the process is open-ended. This is from the scientific perspective now. The process is open-ended as more evidence accumulates. Remember, a hypothesis or even well-confirmed theory is but an idea. The real truth is the actuality. I used to tell my students, science never says they can tell you the absolute truth. Well, what? What am I here for? Well, if you did, that closes the door to any further evidence, and science is always open to evidence. So what then is this footprint we seek? What is our God hypothesis? Would it not be order in nature? Order caused by an uncaused causer that has thus constituting God's footprint in the sands of Heisenberg uncertainty. Now I'm going to get into some concepts here that some of you may not be familiar with, but when you get your copy you can Google and find out what it or look it up later. How else is natural order, including natural law, to be accounted for? How can we conceptualize a null hypothesis in this regard? Perhaps the idea that pure chance can account for natural law and order can serve as this null hypothesis. Pure chance. But do not the odds that chance alone can account for all of the order in the universe and the consistency of this order essentially falsify this hypothesis, especially in consideration of Heisenberg's uncertainty at the quantum level? It seems that it would require much faith to believe this hypothesis. I would suggest that is a null hypothesis, and that the odds are that it's falsified. Heisenberg's jitters vs. jolts. Now I've come up with this new term. You may have heard of quantum jitters before, but that refers to particle antiparticle's appearance in the background field and so on. Here I'm suggesting that, are you familiar with Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and the probability curves that it predicts? Is it a curve like that, and there's a Schrödinger's equation that mathematically describes this. And all of the possibilities there are, options there are possible realities. And the question is, what determines where reality actually exists in that uncertainty situation? I'm going to have to stick to the, Schrödinger's equation maps the extent and shape of its predicted probability waves, but what keeps reality within orderly bounds? Why are there no disrupted jolts? The probability waves allow vast position and momentum options, which extremes, if actualized, would certainly constitute jolts. It suggests you could be in China, but the problem, you know, that's an actual probability, but here you're still in the room, fortunately. Yet nature consists of an orderly progression of universal eigenstates. Got to look that term up. Why so? Whatever determines the orderly decoherence and collapse of probability waves could be defined as God's action. That is his causal joint. As we have argued, the resulting superquantum order we observe evidences the involvement of such sentient intent. Colossians 1:17 states, by him all things hold together. And would not this theistic determinism include even the consistency that allows the laws of nature? From this perspective, the progression of natural process is indeed God at work. Thus, the perspective known as non-theistic naturalism is a conceptual fallacy. Rather, God acting through nature is natural, in that science documents this orderly dynamic in nature. The scientist is actually the colleague of the theologian, not the adversary. As biblically conceived and here implied, God is infinite, including with infinite sentience and omnipotence. Thus, his actions in nature are comprehensively coercive.
5 minutes.
Got to talk fast. The concepts of randomness and chance are then relegated to relativistic perspective and not pertinent from an infinite perspective. Thus, their roles in natural process actually evidence the involvement of this infinite sentience, not the lack of intent as long as order is emergent from the process. As an example, consider genetic mutations. Apparently, Darwin was disturbed by what he perceived as waste mutations. How can deity be involved with intent when mutations occur outside the needs of the adaptive process? His conceptual fallacy was in assuming such a thing as waste from an infinite perspective. Here we argue that the concepts of waste and chance are only of relative perspective. Thus, if a lack of waste were documented in normal natural process, infinite perspective would be disqualified. Have you ever heard that twist before? This, however, does not exclude occasional departure from God's normal process, and I'm going to skip that part. If the future thus is opened by Heisenberg's uncertainty and we have free will, but God actualizes his will even if by contingency, at least in part through his control of quantum events. This is a perspective of theistic determinism. We as free-willed sentient beings are perhaps the best example of complex order in the universe. Thus we best serve as God's footprint, his image, accurate as we are obedient to his will. And absolutely everything matters. That's the reason we're having this debate. What's the conclusion? The conclusion that Bernie's existence is conclusive evidence of God's existence. That's the conclusion. Now I go on and talk about the soul and about Adam and Eve, their answers to all of that.
You
got 4 minutes? Okay. And what of the soul? Is not the emergent quality we possess of sentience, that is self-awareness and ability to conceptualize, and I'm going to illustrate that. I wonder if maybe Bart in the back, could you tell me who this is? Where's Bart? He left. Oh, there you are. Who's this? Tom, who's that?
Albert Einstein.
Well, come on. What? He said Albert Einstein, we're conceptualizing. Not too many, probably, I doubt that any other animal could do that. Just you.
Actually, they can.
Can they? They could distinguish Marilyn Monroe from, anyway.
Not we can. Instance, but other,
yeah, if they recognize themselves in a mirror, that's one of the tests. But anyway, conceptualize. That's, now, and of course, all of this then is in free will choice. These are part of sentience.
All of this is obviously dependent upon normal brain function, but what of its persistence after death of the physical body? Now cosmological developments too involved to detail here make it plausible that dark matter evidences what could be considered a heaven brain, counter universe that is three-dimensionally parallel to our universe and separated by a fourth spatial dimension. That's the firmament in Genesis, you see. You can Google ekpyrotic universe for more detail. It is interesting that the Bible speaks of our having spirit bodies. Could not these be existence in the heaven brain and be counterparts to our earth brain physical bodies? Somehow, perhaps by quantum entanglement, preserving the molecular information that is our identity. Heavenly avatars that receive our souls upon our physical death. And if you've got a heavenly avatar in this model, it's really close to you, but it's through a fourth spatial dimension, see? It's not far away. Our resurrection bodies would thus be six-dimensional. I forgot. Heavenly avatars that receive our souls upon our physical death, and which will serve as templates for our eventual resurrection. Our resurrection bodies would thus be six-dimensional and so able to pass through other dimensions, even into other universes, and yet contain the awareness and self-identity that is known as our soul. Wow, we just got warmed up, but I'm out of time.
You are out of time.
Okay. We'll distribute. I only have 20 that I made up, so if you're couples, maybe you just share one. And that way you can, and also have my email address on it so that you could, if you have questions.
We're supposed to Google the something universe?
Sorry?
You said we're supposed to Google something.
Yeah,
All right, well, thank you very much. We're going to get this started. So if you guys do have a question, just go ahead and raise your hand and state who it's going to be for, and then we'll get these guys up at the podium or in front of the podium, and we'll start our 15 minutes, and we'll milk this for as much as we can, so hopefully we get a little extra time.
Probably until about 7:35, maybe 7:40.
Okay. All righty. So, yeah.
Facts and reason have nothing to do with philosophy. I mean, you can't change anyone's opinion from anything that they philosophically come to a conclusion with. And so I don't know what that has to do with science, but
what was your question?
I think if you, this has more of a statement, but I think if you only have two choices, you can, and that's the, and that's your, you know, multiple two choices, you can lead anybody to believe anything.
Yeah.
I guess one comment I would give on that is you express a common phrase of basically, you know, what's the point of debating people? See, for me,
no, what's the point of debating philosophers?
Okay, so like I said, I think all knowledge is basically in two dimensions, is science and philosophy. Everybody has philosophy, so there's nothing wrong with it. And what we're doing is we're talking about where philosophy and science can overlap. There's actually a mixing area as science overtakes philosophy. For example, in the mind-body problem, it's like how does a mind emerge from chemical processes in the brain? That's called the mind-body problem. And the more we learn from science, the more it takes away from philosophy, because philosophy speculates on what we don't know yet. And, you know, for myself, I used to be a believer, and it's because of debates, I changed my mind. So I would argue with people who say debates don't do anything. I would say, well, I have my own mind to show for that.
Okay. Sorry. I'll go with you first.
I want to ask Dr. McCorkle, where did you study your physics? Because it doesn't quite fit in with what I remember from elementary physics in college.
Which part doesn't fit in?
Well, the part about the jitters and the jolts, when we actually do
Heisenberg uncertainty. Some of these are fairly recent developed concepts,
the
I think.
Heisenberg uncertainty is quite old. It's from the
All right. Place. So you're familiar with that. Now, Heisenberg jitters was my idea versus jolts.
Right, but
it seems logical.
In photons, in things with low mass, with larger mass, you still have the jolts and jitters, but there's more mass, so it's not moved very much. It's harder to measure than in small masses.
But as I understand it, even you and I have a probability wave.
Right.
for position and for momentum both, with many, you know, huge possible. In fact, that's where the idea of multiverse comes from, because then you can have all of the potentials be realities, but in different universes.
Right, but you were proposing dichotomous alternatives, which were very simplistic and didn't fit the situation. Like you said, well, I'm either standing here or I'm sitting on the floor. You can prove I'm not sitting on the floor, therefore I'm standing here. And
no, we falsified that null hypothesis, which gives more credibility to the hypothesis that I'm standing.
But it's too simplistic. Generally, science
the principle.
Pick two random things and say, I'm going to disprove one and I'll prove the other. They use some hints about what's, like, I see you standing there, so I think that's probably true.
That's empirical evidence supporting that hypothesis, but anyway.
I just feel like you have a lot of gaps
There are null hypotheses considered.
Does this book go into it further? Because I would like to hear more about this.
Yeah, and you can Google that term, and they'll explain most of it there. It won't give the idea of a heaven brain or earth brain. That's my contribution.
Right, but even the simplistic idea of because there's not nothing, there must be an unlimited God that we will attribute with unlimited love and knowledge, and because otherwise,
philosophical logic there, and then we went on to address possible evidences, the footprint idea. Yeah.
I've read bad arguments about that. I'd like you to directly come to an argument with that, please.
Just to save time so we can get as many questions as we can, if you guys could maybe grab each other everyone's over and hash that out just a little bit, but thank you for asking.
Can I make one comment on that, too? I think one thing Dave, too, was trying to say, I'm not sure if maybe you're getting more out of what he was trying to say. I think he was saying there's two hypotheses you could have more, but one of them is disproven, he's not saying it proves this one, it's just saying it gives more weight to it. And one thing I want to say about hypotheses is that hypotheses are never proven. What you do is you try to disprove them, and so usually they stand until they're falsified or revised in some better way. So it's not really accurate in science to say anything's ever been proven. You know, like one example is with gravity. Newton had a concept of gravity, Newtonian gravity, and then Einstein came and revised it, and his is going to stand until it gets revised again. And as Dawkins would say, you know, well, gravity's a fact. We know it's there, but the theory is what is getting better and better.
Explanations.
Right, right. So.
You're good. Yeah, for Bernie, I guess I just don't get the point of Dawkins. Long list of photos. Mm-hmm. Let's assume that in that third one you gave the long list of my great grandparents or my super great grandparents, and there never being a soul or a mind in any one of those slices. And so, I mean, what's the point? Does it mean that I don't have a mind now? Clearly, I have a mind now. Clearly, my umpteenth ancestor didn't have a mind. There's no point in between can you say there was an automatic switch from no mind to mind. Well, then I must not have a mind. But wait a second, I do have a mind, and we go through the whole thing again. So what's the point? What's he trying to achieve with this thing? Let's assume, as the AI researchers like to think, that they're going to come up with artificial intelligence in the next X years. Well, we don't have artificial intelligence now. We do X years from now. But if we start taking the slices, we don't. So we never get it. So it must not be possible. And that's a crazy idea. So what's his point? The fact is we do have minds, souls. We didn't at one point in our evolutionary history. So what? Mm-hmm. What's the point?
So the key on all this is a concept called emergence. But before I get into that, are you disputing that there is no such thing as a first human, or do you think there's a first human? Because I think you agree there is no first human. Don't you agree with the evolutionary standpoint on that?
Evolutionarily, there's no first human.
Right.
But there is a time when we say, this is a human being, and then before, this wasn't a human being.
Well, that's Richard Dawkins' point. There is no time where you can say this is a human and his parent is not a human. There is no point in time like that.
Well, then the parallel then is there is no time when you're an adolescent and no time when you're an adult.
The there's no time for one day you're an adolescent, the next day you're an adult.
Absolutely, there is.
No, there's not.
Oh, yes,
it gradually emerges.
By a calendar, maybe, but that doesn't necessarily mean you're an adult.
No, see, the same thing from toddler to infant, too. You can say, like, well, an infant can't walk, and a toddler can. Maybe today my kid took the first steps. Now he's a toddler. Yesterday he wasn't. Well, there's more to toddler than just being able to walk. I mean, there's a whole bunch of things. There's the brain activity, how they...
That's precisely right. So there's no bright line between one and the other. But you don't have to have a bright line to say that there is one and the other. Now, God, being infinitely wise, can choose a bright line if he wants to, or he can just wait until everybody's well past the bright line and then deal with it.
Well, so let me just answer your question. The answer is called emergence, and basically it's things emerge. In artificial intelligence, there's not going to be a time where we had no artificial intelligence, and today scientists have artificial intelligence. It's going to emerge slowly, development upon development. And it's the same thing with our mind. We can study animals. We can see how they have elements of minds. They taught monkeys how to gamble, and they looked at how they gambled, and we learned from human behavior based on what they've done. We
so
see rudimentary things of morality also in animals.
If the mind is an emergent feature, then how does this prevent where's the conflict with Christianity?
Well, this is where we have to find out what a mind is. I mean, this is the whole thing. See, what is the soul? I mean, so that's what I'm saying. If the conflict is that, you know, it's given a conception, you have all these issues. The Catholic Church says the soul is not given to a group of people at once. Well, it can't. Okay, so the Catholic Church says that there's an Adam and Eve, and boom, I give you a soul, and now all your descendants are the only true humans. I mean, so basically, I have to find somebody to make it. There's so many different versions of soul, so it's like, what do you want to do? Do you want to say there's an Adam and Eve, a specific pair, or do you want to say there was a group, or what? What do you want to posit?
Well,
and then we can look at
it. Good question. So your argument might knock down certain versions of Christianity, but certainly not all.
Well, I'm saying there's a different argument for each version. That's what I'm saying. Let's put up a version, and we'll knock it down in a different way. That's my attitude for it.
Let's move on to the next one. Good question. Go for it.
Hi, I have a question for Mr. McCorkle.
Yes.
Okay, so you said that there must be an infinite something. And you define an infinite something as God. I would say if there is an infinite something, it would just be nature. But whether it's just nature or God, since we also exist, does that therefore follow then that we're part of that infinite something that you define to be God?
Well, I think the Bible suggests that we're an image of that, or a reflection of that infinite something. That's with these. If you realize that what's between your ears is the most complex thing in the universe.
So you're saying we're a reflection of an infinite something, so we're not part of what's infinite. So what's left over is not part of infinite.
Yeah, I think you can see that we could really pursue these things to some extent. And I need to think a little bit to understand your question better. And you know, of course, I don't have all the answers. At least I can try. I want to make a couple of statements before our time's gone that I kind of overlooked. One is the matter of theodicy. The question comes up philosophically, is it possible that too much good is bad? And I would say yes, that some bad is good if the resources is good. So in the context that we find ourselves, the Bible says, you know, that the body who feeds the blind, well, it's kind of hard on the prey, but the Bible says God does that. So in this context, some bad is good in this final outcome.
Before we go on too much, I just wanted, is that directly related to that? Okay, guys, I want to catch it off. Just a question in general.
And then the Adam and Eve thing comes as a part we didn't get to on the end.
I do want you to hit on that, and again, I want everybody just to get a question to say. If you guys have one, you have one, you can let him go first. That's the end of your next interview.
Just for Bernie, I just got a curious. Some parts of history are not related to science, such as we believe there was an Alexander the Great and Julius Caesar. There's no science, we just base it on many documentation. And I'm just curious, the Bible, putting aside the supernatural stories in the Bible, do you believe some of its historical things, like lived like there was a King David, King Saul, and what they did, aside from the supernatural, was curious. If you believe it as a historical document, just like you believe that there was an Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, Genghis Khan, and so on.
Well, I guess it's really specifically on what stories. Like, for example, the Bible portrays Adam and Eve as real people. It puts them in genealogies. So, of course not. That's not true. The thing about Moses leading all the people out of Egypt, probably not true. And the evolutionary creationist I mentioned, Dennis Lamoureux, who has three PhDs, I mean, he's like, it's not meant to teach history. It's not a history textbook. It's not a science textbook, you know. It's a theological book. So don't try to make it say something it's not. So, you know, there's a lot of things about Jesus. I think Jesus is mostly a legend. There's some truth there, and there's a lot of stuff made up. It's like when Dan Brown wrote the Da Vinci Code, he put facts and figures in there to try to make it look like a real story. If you want to pass off a story like Joseph Smith did with the Book of Mormon, you're going to try to put in, you know, all kinds of historical things in there to see people say, like, well, obviously it's true, because look, you know, this stuff relates to real life. So that's why I see it kind of a lot of legend in there. And, you know, Jesus may be a real person. I'm not an expert on it. I would point to somebody like Bart Ehrman, who's also a former Christian and a theologian. He's a biblical expert.
We're going to push it back. Sorry,
I'm not going to ask you, please. Do you believe that the Bible is exactly the word of God, written by God, or by God through some person or people? If so, when did that happen? And the answer is no, then who wrote the parts that God did?
To really answer that would, I think, need a whole other session, but I think there are evidences that validate the historical aspects of the different parts of it. For instance, the flood story it's in many of the ancient literatures, and the fact that the Bible has it too certainly validates that historical aspect of it. But I also think that there is hidden meaning there, what I call unwitting allegory, that the authors couldn't have had to, how would the authors know what plasmas are? And yet they talk about the firmament with waters above and below. Hey, that fits the model perfectly. The firmament is that fourth dimension, and at the big smash part, all matter becomes plasma on each side. It fits perfectly, but there's no way they could have known that. So how can it be there if it's not inspired? That's my conclusion. If it's not inspired.
Inspired by
yes.
God.
Yes. Yes. I think that there would be a reason for it there, but it isn't always literal in the sense that it might be taken that way. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
So you were philosophically proving that there's an infinite God in the universe. I didn't really follow all that. I kind of got stuck in the
I know.
Absolutely nothing
but you can read it there, though. I mean, does that help?
But the point is, the question is, how do you get from there's an infinite God in the universe
mm-hmm.
to it's a Christian God, considering all the historical inaccuracies, scientific inaccuracies, contradictions of the Bible? How does that prove, how do you connect the two at all together?
Well, I kind of suggested there can be hidden meaning there that I don't know how to explain other than it's divinely inspired. And I think there's also a lot of accounts that tie it, that validate its historicity. That's what the people thought at that time, but that may not necessarily, in you know, that concept, be reality. And that kind of confuses it almost more, doesn't it?
No, but I mean, you were saying that it's validated when it's just the opposite. It's been invalidated. Even Israel admits that they cannot, there's no archaeological evidence for so many of the things in the Bible. They just say that they're myths. They're not true.
Well, I haven't told you, but I was born in Iraq. My parents were missionaries there. And they had occasion, and I won't go into the details, to acquire a Babylonian brick that his cuneiform inscription in it. And from the message on there, it's obvious it was part of King Nebuchadnezzar's palace. And there's a phrase on that brick that matches the Daniel